That was her son. He had they had that home going on yesterday, and he also was 29. That's two of them that was in their 20s. All right, under family and friends, amen. I am not going to call all of these names, but I wanted to list them there for the sake of time. And under nursing home and hospice care, Mother Velma Archer. And then also I have listed our President Barack Obama and his family. And also we're praying for our global and local missions entities listed here and our covenant and affiliate churches. Amen. And it's just prayer time. So we're going to ask everyone to please stand. Join hands with the person on your row. Just hold hands with that person. And while you're standing there holding their hand, just go ahead and softly find out what they need from God the most right now. So it's going to be a little dialoguing for just a minute. So I just want to know one thing that you need from God in a hurry. Don't shake your head and say you don't need anything. Stand proxy for somebody else. All of us need something today. Amen. And God said that we could ask and it would be given. So if you'll bow your heads all over this building and close your eyes. Father, in the name of Jesus, we come before your majestic presence, thanking you for this day you've given us, a day we have never seen and will never see again. We thank you that you have afforded us this wonderful blessing. And we don't take it lightly. The fact that we were able to get up and wash our face and brush our teeth and put on our clothes. Nobody had to dress us. We were able to dress ourselves. We were able to go out of our homes. Thank God we had a home to go out of. And then we went outside and got in our vehicle. Those of us that have cars, those of us that are getting ready to have cars because you got in somebody's car, we just want to say thank you. There's so many things that we don't really stop and give you thanks for, but today, God, we just want to cover all the categories. We thank you and praise you for everything you do for us. And you sure did the right thing when you saw the condition of man. And you said, you know what? I don't know. Maybe I made a mistake in creating man. They've become so sinful. But then Jesus said, if you prepare me a body, I'll go down and I'll redeem them. So you came to earth in the flesh of your son and you died for us. So for this, we say thank you. I don't know too many of us in the room right now would give up our children to die for this world. But you gave the ultimate sacrifice. And for this, we say thank you. We thank you and praise you for the bereaved on our prayer list. We're praying, oh God, for those families that have lost loved ones suddenly. Sometimes, oh God, when our loved ones have been ill for a long time, we can deal with it a little bit better. But God, when they're snatched away from us in a hurry, we're blindsided. We didn't see it coming. But God, we want to thank you that you gave them the years you did. Your word says that you take us out of this world early from the evil that's to come. So God, we thank you that they were saved. And we know that to be absent in the body is to be present with you. So we thank you for their lives. We thank you, oh God, for those that may be in the hospital. We thank you and praise you right now, God, that you are yet a healer. We thank you, Lord God, for all of those that may be sick in their homes and they're homebound. We thank you, Lord God, even for Mother Velma Archer in the nursing facility. We thank you, Lord God, for our president and his family. We thank you, Lord God, for the 8 years that you allowed him to remain in the White House. God, I'm sure there were some attempts and some threats made on his life. But God, I want to thank you for how we kept him on the prayer list for the entire time. And we want to say thank you for keeping him in the name of Jesus. God, we thank you for all of our military personnel that may be deployed and those that are yet stateside. We thank you and praise you, Lord God. Hallelujah. For even my godson, Amir Henderson, being in the house. God, I want to thank you for this young man. He's special to me. And God, he is somewhere in this audience. And I just want you to cover him with the blood of Jesus. I thank you, Lord God, that he is a success already, whether he knows it or not. God, I want to thank you now for the person that we're standing next to, that person, oh God, that has already made a request known. God, I want to thank you right now that you are here for the express purpose to bless somebody. You are here to deposit a miracle. And so, God, I thank you for the signs and wonders that are going to accompany your word on today. I thank you for Coach McKissick. I thank you for his wife. I thank you for his children. God, I thank you for the word you have impregnated him with. And now, God, I need for you to touch our ears that we might hear and receive your word. God, I thank you for the young lady that's in the audience now. It's more than one. They don't even know why they came today. Some of them, oh God, are going through financially. But God, I want to thank you for the financial miracle that has already been released from the third heaven. God, I want to just intercede for the young man, the young father, hallelujah, that has a job, but it just doesn't pay enough money to make ends meet. But God, I thank you that you're giving him witty inventions. You're giving him ideas, creative ideas and concepts, so that he will be able to go out and provide for his family. Thank you, Lord God, for the mothers. Thank you for the seniors. Thank you for all of those, oh God, in our midst. Every visitor, God, we thank you. And we ask that you would bless every household. Thank you, Lord God, for the unsaved, because God, I know you can save. Hallelujah. Thank you for the backslider. You can restore them. Thank you, Lord God, for every saved individual. Thank you for every child. Thank you for every teenager. Thank you for every mother, every father, in the name of Jesus. And we thank you, and we're gonna give you the glory, because you are worthy. In Jesus' name it is so. Amen. Lean over to about two people, one on one side and one on the other side, and just tell them, say, neighbor, you can pray about something else now. Say, because God's already done that thing. Tell them, say, pray about something else. God's already done it. Hallelujah. Some of y'all didn't even say it. Tell somebody else. Tell two more folk. Maybe you'll get the right one. Tell them, the neighbor, God's already done it. Pray about something else. I feel real churchy. I feel kind of a little Baptist-y.
My despair to show me you would never leave me there. You claim because I was made for so much more. I am your child, and I'm worth fighting for. Though heavy with the weight of my mistakes, you carry me and refuse to let me sink under the pressure. You meant for me to soar. I am your child, and I'm worth fighting for. Eyes haven't seen, ears haven't heard all you have planned for me. And nothing can separate me from your love when there's so much more still worth fighting for. Now I'm moving by faith and not by sight, towards victory by the power of your might. You're straightening out my path and opening every door. I am your child, and I'm worth fighting for. Eyes haven't seen, ears haven't heard all you have planned for me. And nothing can separate me from your love when there's so much more still worth fighting for. And that's why I'm pressing towards the mark, because the calling on my life is worth fighting for. And I keep my mind stayed on you, Jesus, because the peace it brings is worth fighting for. And I'll be faithful for my wife and children, because my family is worth fighting for. No, this world is not my home, but your kingdom here is worth fighting for. I got a mansion over in glory, and my new home is worth fighting for. Till I see it, I'll shout hallelujah here, 'cause my praise is worth fighting for. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Life with you is worth fighting for. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Life with you is worth fighting for. Eyes haven't seen, ears haven't heard, all you have planned for me. There is so much more still worth fighting for.
Opportunity. It's a wonderful opportunity to just hug someone next to you. You never know until you know. Don't be a spectator this morning. Don't be a spectator. Sit down on Jesus. Don't give up on him, because he won't give up on you. This is a moment of worship. This is an opportune moment for you to thank God just for bringing you here this morning. Spirit of the Lord is here. If you don't feel it, I feel bad for you. But the Spirit of the Lord is in this building. Can I get an amen? Can I get an amen? Can I get a hallelujah? Can I get a thank you, Jesus? Does anybody believe that your family is worth fighting for? Does anybody believe that your life is worth fighting for? Do you believe that the calling that God has put on your life is worth fighting for? See, the devil tells us that it's not worth fighting for. Just give up. We have no need for you. But you're really worth fighting for. Now this morning, we're here. We're celebrating with our athletes, with the Fellowship of Christian Athletes. This summer, we had a camp. It was Rise Up. This is an athlete Bible that we have. We have a, first and foremost, I want to thank God just for putting the call on my life. You know, if you know me, you know that I would have never thought that I would be in this moment right here. But God. But God. I want to thank Bishop Collins for allowing me to feed the flock this morning. I don't take it lightly. I want to thank my lovely wife. She is definitely my secret ingredient. If you want to know why, if you want to know the change, what is it about him back there on that wall? She is the reason for the change. That's pretty evident if you knew me. I see we have, could we have the Mondays Mill family stand up? Mondays Mill. This is Mundy's Mill High School. Now you guys, Coach Calloway is an amazing guy. He's one of my mentors. He's another guy, and I respect a man that loves his wife. Every time you hear from Coach Calloway, he's telling you about his wife. Oh, man, I got my wife, my wife, my wife. He loves his wife, and he does whatever it takes to keep her happy, his wife and his kids. He's definitely a great mentor, and you guys will go far if you follow his tutelage. Now we have my Sandy Creek family, if you stand up. We have our girls team here. Our girls team, they're here. We have Coach Hodges, Coach Lott, and Coach Cole. We also have our boys team here with the coaching staff, and they're all looking forward to a great year. We just came off a 24-hour camp where we slept at the school. We practiced all day and every day. And these guys, they're really a special group of young men. Great, they have great fathers in their life, and it's evident. Great mothers, great parents. So if you could just clap for these young people that came today. We also have Brother Neely, who's the FCA representative for Fayette County. If you could stand up or wave your hand if you're still in here. Okay, it is our tradition that we stand up to reverence God's word. So if you're willing and able, I will ask you to do so. You can meet me in the book of Joshua, the first chapter in the 9th verse. I repeat, our rendezvous point for this morning's word is Joshua 1:9. We'll read this in concert from the King James Version. If you have another version, please read silently to yourself. Now, I know you've heard this text preached 3 times in the last 2 months. It is what it is. That's what God gave me. Have I not commanded thee, be strong and of good courage, be not afraid, neither thou be dismayed, for the Lord thy God is with thee whithersoever thou goest. This is the word of God for the people of God. With the people of God, say thanks be to God.
Thanks be to God.
God, I thank you this morning for this preaching and teaching moment. I thank you for decreasing me and increasing yourself, God. I thank you for what you're going to do in this place. I thank you that no one is here on mistake, God. I know they did not come for a talent show. They did not come for a pep rally. They came for a word from you, God. And I thank you for allowing me to be the vessel that you will use this morning to just bring forth your word, God. I thank you for those people who are on their last step. They're on their last end. And they said, if I can only get in the house of the Lord, I know you will bless me today, God. I know it's somebody, God. Just touch them in a special way, God. Let them know that you have not forgotten about them, God. Let them know that you've been on their mind. God, thank you for what you're about to do. In your holy name, amen. Now, before you take your seats, I got a little bit of exercise for you. 4 people, because there's 4 points, and not the people you came with. That's the problem. We only talk to the people we came with, and we never grow. Find them, and this will be the title of my message. It's R-I-S-E, rise up, and you must spell it out to them. Find 4 people and tell them R-I-S-E, rise up. Now, once you've done that, you may take your seats. Well, if you told your fourth person to rise up, you may take your seat. Now, how many of you this morning feel like that you're long overdue to rise up? Or is it just me? Now, this rise, it may be spiritually. It may be economically. It may be relationally. Or it may just be personal. But we all need to rise up. I know that I do. Whatever it means to you, it does not matter. It is time to rise up. The word that God gave me for you is that it's time to rise up. Now, I won't be before you long. I know we have people that need to go in the water. I know we have Holy Communion. Just give me 10 minutes, and I challenge you to take notes so that you can take this home with you. Now, I'll give you four keys to rise up, and it's an acronym for RISE. And the way I see it is that we have doors that are keeping us from rising up. They're closing in our face. They may be doors of pornography. They may be doors of depression. They may be doors of just bad relationships. They may be doors of a boss at work that they won't let us get to where we're trying to go. So if you have the key on your spiritual keychain, you will know how to rise up. Now, a lot of us, we have keys, but we have all the keys for the wrong places. You need to equip yourself for the keys that are going to get you in the doors that you're trying to have open. You can't always complain that doors are being closed in your face and you can't get into them because you don't have the keys. And whose fault is it that you don't have the key? Because the keys are available. Now, the first key that I will give you is remembrance. The key of remembrance. You have to remember what God has promised you. Remember what God has promised you. If you look at the text, Joshua 1 and 9, when we start, it says, after the death of Moses, the servant of the Lord. Now, stay with me, and I'll come back and get you if I lost you. But after, that means something happened before this. The before was the death of Moses. My servant is dead. The Lord said to Joshua, son of Nun, Moses' aid, my servant is dead. Now then, you all the people, get ready to cross over the Jordan. It continues to say that no one will be able to stand against you. I will be with you wherever you go. So the first thing you have to do is you have to remember what God has promised you. And if you remember these things, you'll rise up. The reason that we don't remember it because we forgot. When the devil tells us one thing and we don't remember what God said, we're not able to rise up. So what we have here is a transition from Moses to Joshua. Now that the curse of Moses has been lifted, God is saying, it's your time. How many of you people believe that it is your time? You've been in that desert moment for too long. You've been just struggling for too long. You've been in debt for too long. That relationship has been bad for too long. You've been passed over for too long. Is it just me? Is it just me? But what you have to realize, and this may not flow the way you want it to, but Moses, take it back now. After Moses died, then what happened? It was time to transition. So what you have to understand, what was Moses? A lot of you see Moses as the person who set them free. But if you really study the text, you'll see that Moses was a leader. He was the leader of the people that disobeyed God. That's the reason they were in the wilderness, because they were disobedient. They did not obey what God said. So Moses is the person that led the people that disobeyed God. Moses didn't disobey God, but his people did. So first thing you have to do to rise up, you have to remember God's promises, and your Moses has to die. Whatever it is that's leading you to disobey God has to die before you can cross over to that promised land. So a lot of us, we don't want to think of Moses as a bad thing, but we all have Moses's in our life. That Moses that's telling us that we need to skip school. That Moses is telling us that we don't need to go to work today. We'll just call in sick when we know we're not sick. There's a lot of Moses that we have. but that Moses must die. You can't go over because the curse won't be lifted until the Moses in your life has died. And some of you, you're staring at me, but you know good and well what your Moses is. You can't clap. You can't clap. You can't say amen because you're sitting with your Moses. That's why you're so quiet in here, because you know where you're sitting right with your Moses. Or you watching the clock because you're going to leave out 30 minutes early to meet your Moses. I wish I had a church that wanted the truth. See, I can't give you nothing but the truth. They said, give it to them like it is. If you're sitting with your Moses, all you got to do is repent. It is what it is. Let it go. So, the problem is that we believe what the world says and not what the word says. And the promises of God, there's a couple of things that stuck in my mind. It says the world says that you're broke, but the word says that you're a child of a king. The world says that for the kids, you're ugly, you're your daddy's son. But the word says that I'm made in my father's image, so I know that I'm beautiful. The world says that in order to get that man, this is for all the single ladies, that I got to get in the bed with him. Oh, we quiet now, huh? Okay. Well, y'all not in the same world that I was in? Because that was the key when I was in the world. Are we not sleeping around anymore? Oh, okay. But the word says in Ruth that all you have to do is lay at his feet. Just you don't have to get in the bed. Just lay by the bed. Lay by the bed. And when he smells your brother, dude, what's going on? Hey, you won't even have to work another day in your life. Okay, y'all came to play church, but I'm not playing this morning. So the first key this morning that you must equip yourself with is that you have to remember God's promises. That's your R. And after Joshua was told it's time to go over, he sent two spies over from the land of Shittim. These two spies, they went over, they crossed the Jordan ahead of them. How many of you know that somebody's spying on you? Whatever God's getting ready to transition you, he'll send somebody to evaluate you. Are you ready for what God has for you? You think the test is a bad thing, but in reality, the test is a test to see if you're ready to cross over. Somebody's looking at you right now. There's somebody that has your blessings in their hands, but they're saying he doesn't really want it. He doesn't want it like he says he wants it. She doesn't want it like she says she wants it. Every time I present this to her, she takes it when she should not. So the second key, and this is what happens when the spies went over, they went into the house of a harlot named Rahab. And Rahab, the king of Jericho, was tipped off. Hey, there's somebody over here. They're about to take your land. And there's two spies, and they in the house of the harlot. And if you don't know what a harlot is, it's what the young people call a thought for hire. See, she sold her body to make money. She was a self-employed employee of herself. She used what she had to get what you had, and she spent it on other people. So when the men came to take the spies, she said, oh, they were here, but they left. She hid them. How many of you know that God will hide great things in bad places? Let me say that again for the people on this side of the church. How many of you know that God will hide great things in bad places? So if you've ever looked at yourself and said, I know I'm bad. God, I don't deserve anything. I hate to tell you that God hid something great within you, even when you were bad. Everything that you needed, you already had. So your second point is to identify your Rahab. Now, what Rahab is, it's a hiding place. See, God will hide us when we're not ready to be presented to the world. And that hiding place is somewhere that you must stay in order to be hidden, so you can develop, Some of us, we're underground right now. You think you're buried, but you're really planted. And you get watered, and you grow, and you grow. And by the time that you come out the ground, nobody can take you out. Now what she did was she helped the men hide. She helped the men hide, and she let a rope out her window, and the men came down the rope, and they made a pact with her. They said, now, since you helped me, you hid me, then when we come in and we take the city, we're going to spare your life and anybody within your house. See, sometimes you have to make deals with people that, you know, they're just not the kind, they ain't church people. And it's okay. It's okay to do business with people of the world as long as you don't turn to the people of the world. See, you can't always do business within the church. That is what's wrong with the church. We don't leave the church. We get saved, we get prayed up, then we go out there and act like we don't know you. Oh, he's a sinner. Oh, I saw her doing this. She just left this place. See, we have to be better than that. So the deal was, as long as you stay within the house, you're good. Leave this rope hanging out your window. And when we come into the town, we'll spare you. The second part to deal was, as long as you keep quiet, don't tell anyone about this. So this prophetic warning for you all, stay in the house. See, so you found your hiding place, but you like to get out of that place. God told you exactly where you wanted to be, but the world presented a better option. Stay in the house. That's why you need a church home. That's why you need a spiritual covering, because when you're covered, they can pray for you. They can fight things off better than you can because they've been equipped. They've been called by God. But a lot of us, we don't want to do that because it's messy in the church. Because that's not your job to worry about what's going on in your church. That's the bishop's job. That's your pastor's job to fix what's going on within the church. Your job is to come and be blessed. Just come be blessed. The second thing, the second warning, and I really need you to say this as nice as possible to someone close to you. Lean over to them. Tell them, be quiet. You don't have to tell everything. Keep your mouth closed sometimes. Sometimes we just talk too much. We talk way too much. The word said, they told her, you can't tell anybody about this. Sometimes we have these things, and God has put in the word in our or a vision in our mind, and the first thing we do is we go tell Pookie. And Pookie, before your thing even resonates, Pookie already got a plan to kill you. Right when you come up, here go Pookie. Oh, no, I see him. And they'll try to tarnish what you're doing so they can get it. So you really have to watch who you're talking to. Watch your bed partners. Watch who you're laying with. Watch who you got the pillow talk with. You can't talk to everybody. And you got to stay in the house. So the first thing is to remember God's promises. The second thing is to identify your Rahab. Get in the house, stay in the house, and close your mouth. If you don't take anything from today, just get in the house. Stay in the house and close your mouth. Don't talk yourself out of a blessing. Don't talk yourself out of a blessing. Men, don't talk yourself out of a blessing. Women, don't talk yourself out of a blessing. Don't let your mouth be the reason that your feet can't walk into a certain place. Because you're, you know, the image of you goes before you. And people talk about, oh, I know what you're about, even if you're not about it, but you just talk too much sometimes. Jesus. Now, the third key is to stand up. Stand up for what you believe in. Because you have to understand, when the men were ready to cross the Jordan, they sent the priest, and he stood up in the Jordan, and the water stopped. It just stopped. Do you understand when you're ready to rise up, there will be things that are not going to like it. There will be people who are going to say, not you. You're supposed to be hanging with me. Who, you think you're better than me now? Who are you to think you're saved? I remember when. I remember this. I remember last night. So now you think you're saved, you think you're better than us. And what you have to understand is that when the priest set foot in the Jordan, the water stopped. So when you, as a godly people, step foot into a place, things should stop. Business should not be as usual. If you step into a room and things keep going the way they've been going, there's something up with you. There's something, you might not be as spiritual as you think you are. Because right when they stepped foot, and this was a time that it was usually flooding, the Jordan was overflowing. So, I mean, there was a lot of things that could have took you out. So when you go to work and they talking, how they talk, about who they talk about, and they don't start whispering when you come in, that should tell you something. When they cussing and yelling and fussing and fighting, and you come in and they just invite you to the conversation, that should tell you something. When all your friends are messy, we'll leave it at that. So, remember what God promised you. Identify your Rahab. Find the house, get in the house, close your mouth. Stand up for what you believe in. We're in a time right now that we're not allowed to stand up for what we believe in. If we have the whole, you know, police brutality, and if you say that Black Lives Matter, then they're saying that you're saying that police don't matter. And if you say that blue lives matter, then you're saying that black lives don't matter. And they treat you like an Uncle Tom and just somebody who's sold out. And they won't even talk to you until they need something. And then they're back friends again. And you have to vote for one candidate because you don't like the other one. It's not necessarily that one is so good. It's because you don't like the other one. So now we've created a culture, and we cultivate a culture where I like you not because I like you. I like you because I don't like who you don't like. And that's the same culture that says that we can shack up. It's not that I love you. I just love that my bills are now going to be paid. That's what we're feeding our young people. That's the example that we're showing. We're showing an example that I ain't got to like you. I just don't like who you don't like. So now we can be friends. And when the who you don't like moves on, now I'm looking at you like, why are we here? What are we doing? What are we doing? Why are we hanging out? And then we go through all this drama. Now, I may lose you with this last E, but if you circle back to the beginning of my pericope, we were with Moses. And Moses' people could not go into the land that was promised to them because of their disobedience. So the E, expand your thought process. You have to change the way you think. You can't go on doing things the way you've been doing. If they would have just changed the way they thought and been obedient, we wouldn't have had a rise because we'd already been there. There would have been no reason to rise up because they would have walked into the promised land. Yeah. See, a lot of us were just like the people of Moses. We get out of something. God blesses us. We get out, and we try our best to get back. We want to do whatever it takes to get back. At least we had onions to eat. You know, yeah, he beat me, but at least he paid the bills. You know, yeah, she's cheating on me, but at least she looked good. That's the lifestyle we're living right now. We can't change our mind. No, I can't go over there. Those white folks. No, I can't talk to the white folks because white folks don't like black folks, and slavery was 400 years ago, and we still don't like them because of that. We're going to hold our black money. Now, we're not going to spend our money in your store, and you ain't even got no money. I'm just keeping it real. We have to change the way we think. We have to change our mindset. We have to start teaching our children about business and entrepreneurship. And we have to teach our children that just because you go to church doesn't mean you're saved. And just because you don't go to church does not mean you're a sinner. There's a lot of things that we have to change in this world. But the biggest thing that I'm leaving with you is that whatever you have to rise up from, you have the keys already in your mind, already in your heart. God has given us everything that we need to rise up. And the doors of the church are open right now. And I have my ministers come down. And I just want you to think, what is it that I need to rise up from? What is it that I need to rise over? What is it that I need to rise to? Am I the reason that I have not risen up? Is it my same sin over and over and over? We all have that one sin that we just can't seem to shake. But if you change your thought process, do something different. Stop doing the same thing over and over and over and thinking you're going to get a different result. It doesn't work that way. If you just need prayer, it's a great time. God, I'm just tired. I don't like the way my life is going. I seem to be stuck in a stagnant state. You promised me this, but I have yet to see it. You gave me a lot of promises, but I haven't seen any of them. Which door are you trapped behind? Do you not remember what God has told you because you don't read your word? The only word you get is Sunday. Are you having problems identifying your Rahab, your hiding place? Do you not have a hiding place? Do you need someone to help you find a hiding place? This is an opportunity for you to come down and get prayer. Are you afraid to stand up and be different? Are you afraid that they're going to pick on you if you decide that you want to stand up for God? That you don't want to be the kid in the school cussing? Too cool for school is what I always call it. Do you just need to expand your thought process? And as I said, I didn't come to put on a show. This is an opportunity for you to minister to the people. We're praying up front. We're praying in the audience. This is a time of prayer and remembrance. If you don't know Jesus, you've never met him, this is your first time hearing about this guy who will save your life, who's already saved your life, it's a good opportunity to come down. Tomorrow is not promised. It's more evident in the time as now. Tomorrow is not promised. Ask your neighbor, are you saved? Don't waste another moment assuming that the person beside you is already saved. And let them know that you'll walk with them. You'll stand up with them and walk with them. If you've backslidden, you had it right, but you no longer have it right, and you want to get it right, please come. I beg you to come. Too often, we're here on Sunday and not on Monday. We play church. We do a lot of playing, but the devil's not playing. He came to kill, steal, and destroy. Is there anyone else who needs prayer? Make sure you don't miss this moment. Make sure you're not sitting and watching and miss the moment. Don't miss the moment. Don't miss the moment. Don't miss the moment. That's what I keep hearing. Don't miss the moment. Don't miss the moment. Stop assuming that you got more time than you really do. We don't have time to waste. Don't miss your moment. Don't miss your moment. We should be clapping. We should be celebrating right now. We should be celebrating right now. We should be celebrating right now. This is what it's all about. It's not about how good you look. It's not about who you know. It's about the kingdom. is about enhancing the kingdom. It takes a lot of courage to walk up here. And these young people have more courage than a lot of us adults. Don't miss your moment. Don't leave out of here the same way you came in. It is not guaranteed that tomorrow will come and you'll be a part of this world. Every day we lose lives. How do you know that it's you that needs to come up? There's a little feeling inside of you. There's a little feeling that says there's something that's different right now. There's a pull. There's a pull. That pull is God. Just because you come up doesn't mean you're saying you're perfect and you're ready to stop everything that you're doing. It just said, I'm ready for something different. Is there anybody that's ready for something different? You're tired of the usual. You just want something different. Something has to give. Something has to change. Something has to change. All week, God is able has been on my mind. Is that God, He is still able to do everything that He promised you. Don't give up on Him. Don't give up on God. Please don't give up on God. Is there anyone that's dealing with a health problem today? You know you have a sickness in your body and you're ready to let it go. This call is for a health problem. You have a health issue in your body. Something with the blood. I hear the blood. Somebody, is there anyone who has a blood issue right now? A blood issue. If you have a blood issue, please come up. God said that His blood is in you. His blood is running through your veins. So if His blood is going, he shed His blood for you. The Lamb has been shed. The price has been paid. Just believe it and you will receive it. There's a married couple that's thinking about getting a divorce. Now, I understand that you probably won't come up here. You probably won't come up here because it's too embarrassing. It's too embarrassing to figure out, I ain't got it all together. I front like I do, but it's not what it looks like it is. There is a married couple that's thinking about getting divorced. And you're not so sure if that's what you want to do. You are in here. I know you're in here. I listen to God when He talks to me. You're here. If you're bold enough, come up. You really want to fight for your family, come up. Let them save your marriage. Divorce ain't pretty. You can make it through it, but it's not so pretty. If you're dealing with an issue in your marriage, God can fix anything. He can fix it. You just got to give it to Him. You got to give it to Him. It's you. God can fix it. God can fix it. I've been there. I've been through the water and the fire. You don't. This one is big. Somebody's contemplating suicide. And this is not the time to play. Somebody thinks that their life isn't worth anything. Somebody is contemplating suicide. It happens more often than you think. If you thought, if you've had the umption that the world would be better without you, please believe that that's a lie. It's a lie. You are loved. God loves you. There's a lot of people that love you. Can we pray? Can we please accept and pray? This is a time that we should be worshiping. We should be thanking God for the barriers that are being broken right now. There are walls that are falling in this place. You don't have to leave how you came. You do not have to leave how you came. You really don't. Would everybody touch somebody and just pray for them? Ask them what it is that they need and just pray for them. Older people, pray for the younger people, because they may not know how to pray for themselves. I need all the older people to move in the direction of a younger person. There's plenty here today, and it's not guaranteed that they'll be back to any more church services this year. All of the seasoned saints, please move in the direction. There's a group here, there's a group there, there's a group over here. Please don't sit down on God. I need my ministers to move in the direction of a young person. You don't have to believe what the devil's telling you. Young ladies, you don't have to do what all the other girls at the school does. You don't have to be that way. You can be what God has called you to be. I see a lot of young people, and there's no adults touching or talking to them. The reason that Moses' people got stuck in the wilderness because they were disobedient. Don't let the young people go through the same things that you went through. You went through it so they don't have to. But sometimes we're too big, we're too bold, we're too tough to talk to somebody. We're too tough to lay hands. Don't let this be a tough moment. Let this be a soft, loving moment. Somebody's in the need of prayer. The Spirit is here. Get what you came for. Get exactly what you came for.
If we have any individuals who got saved when you came up, I need for you to just return real quick. If you got saved, if you are a member of this church and you rededicated your life or you were restored, I need for you to just make your way back up just for a second. Amen. I want y'all to see who got saved. Up on the podium, come on up with me. They're going to give their names and they're going to let you know if they have confessed Jesus as Lord of their lives. I don't like for you to go out of here without people knowing, because you can come in here unsaved and you can leave unsaved. But I believe in giving you an opportunity to openly confess Jesus as Lord. And you've done that with the ministers who prayed with you. But if you got saved today, and I want you to say your name, and then when you get through saying your name, and don't be ashamed of it, I want you to say, my name is, and I'm saved. Y'all got it? Come on, get excited. You know, heaven is having convulsions over one sinner. All right, y'all ready?
Okay. My name is Christopher Williams, and I got saved today.
My name is Gabriel Fadika, and I got saved today.
My name is Tori Cummings, and I got saved today.
My name is Bilal, and I got saved today.
My name is Jalen Thrash, and I got saved today.
My name is Keyshawn Jones, and I got saved today.
My name is Jalen Harris, and I got saved today.
My name is Jalen Miller, and I got saved today.
Hello, my name is Casey, and I got saved today.
We want to hear him now, okay? Okay, let's hear him.
My name is Casey, I got saved today. My name is Amara, I just got saved today.
My name is Morgan, I just got saved today.
Now we can have some convulsions like heaven. Now we can join the party. Oh, God. We're not going to let heaven outdo us. They act like this when one gets saved. How many we got? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. Somebody said we need to give God a praise on a scale of 11. Praise God. Where's Coach? Where's Coach? Coach, I need you to hug every last one of them. He's going to put his arms around. His prayers have not been in vain. I don't know if they want to join our church. We don't twist arms over here. Amen. But they need to get in the church. Amen. And now what they've just done is taken our little 45 up to what's 45 plus 11? 56. Oh, my God. Will somebody give God a crazy praise for 56? Come on, saints. 56 souls have gotten saved this year in this church. I don't know about the one up the street. Hallelujah. All right. I need somebody from...
Now we have these athlete Bibles that we got from Neely here. FCA guy, Neely. And this is a Bible for the young athletes. And what we want to do, now they said, hey, they're free. But if you want to donate and help out, you can. They're $9. I want to buy, we can buy all of these young people one of these Bibles. Is that something that we can do?
Yes, it is.
That's $99, right? We can buy them right now. They're over there in the box. He did say they were free, but we don't want to leave empty-handed. We want to donate to the FCA. But he did say they were free. Want to put it out there like that. Does anybody want to buy one of these young people a Bible?
Look, y'all bring me the Bibles. I got to see what I'm getting. Show me the Bible. I want to see that I'm getting what I'm paying for. My God, I want to put my Bible in the hand. Jesus. Hallelujah, somebody. That's right, musician. There's some things we got to hear. We got to be able to hear. Hey. 9 plus 9 is 18. So that means $2, a $2 donation. I guess that go to Neely. $2. Or it don't go to you. Well, whoever did. $2 on another Bible then. That's right. Y'all should have had that box already open. Good God Almighty. Somebody asked me, did I have a box cutter? I said, do I look like somebody that carry a box cutter? What you really saying? What you saying? What you saying? Bishop, you got a box cutter. Do I look like?